Okay, here we go, Virginie. Thank
you. Okay, so first, thanks a lot for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here. Bear with me because I'm having actually a big migraine, so I have a lot of perceptual echoes going on in my head, but I'll try to be articulate nevertheless. So I think I have a big title that's not going to be as pompous as the title is really. But since everyone or some people have shared their obsessions, here's one of mine. By rereading Shannon recently, I bumped into these few sentences there. You can read in yellow. And the one being most relevant is the semantic aspects of communication are irrelevant to the engineering problem. Yet we approach the brain, we tend to approach the brain as an information processing system. So I put it out there because I think sometimes we forget that we're dealing with a biological entity and information theory might have its limits. In any case, I guess oscillators will sort of agree with the notion that neural oscillation may actually implement a time matrix for information processing in the brain, at least when we come from speech aspect. And so I'm going to do a bit of ramblings before going into the speech, so there'll be three parts in this talk. A little bit of ramblings about what computational goals might neural oscillation fulfill. Basically, most of us are interested with cortex, which is what has been called a slave oscillator, meaning that it's not going to be entrained by the daylight, for instance, but by something else. And so one of the questions could be, what is that something else? Here I've listed some of the terms that we heard a lot since the beginning of the symposium or the workshop, and that we hear a lot also in going through the different articles. So here I'm doing a tentative simplification here of what it might mean with the pun on the representational enslavement, because we don't actually know what representation might mean. But nevertheless, simplifying with the fact that we may be entraining from information from the outside as an information-based entrainment or enslavement, top-down being distal enslavement with respect to the what is the mapping that we're trying to code for, and then I'll spend a lot of time on the anatomical enslavement. For the representational enslavement, we've heard a lot about this notion of alignment to sensory stimulation, which means that basically one major function of neural oscillation would be to time with respect to input systems. So I've listed randomly, and there are many more studies we could list here. And some of these studies have been inspired by the dynamic attending theory, basically specifying that we are expecting a time input based on these oscillators, hence we are looking at a phenomenon that is akin to a temporal attention, and this would have consequences on sensory predictions and the precision of information encoding. What I'd like to draw attention to is a small psychophysics study we had done with Anne Cossem. I will refer to her often. She's in the room somewhere there. So in this study, what we used is this notion of entrainment, but I think it's a bit more complex than just saying that it's a temporal attention. Because in this visual search paradigm, your goal here as a subject would be to find the bar, which is vertical or horizontal. And you could hear sound, which I guess doesn't work. There would be sound that would be timed with the bar, which is horizontal or vertical. So now I didn't keep track of which stimulus it was. And it's somewhere, but I can't find it. So anyway, so when you have the sound that's being presented at the same time as the flickering target, then you're going to have a speed up of a reaction time, and you're going to have an improvement of the detection of this visual target. But what's most interesting is that when you entirely anti-correlate the sound and the visual event, the visual target, then you get a slowdown of the reaction time, and you also get an impairment in the detection. So the reason that I find that kind of results interesting, and that it goes beyond, I think, to the simple detection paradigm, is that in one case, even though you have two sensory streams of information that do not a priori specify an object, in one case the temporal co-modulation tells you it's the same object, and in the other case it tells you it is not the same object. But I think it leads to a bit of a tension between what we mean by temporal predictability and efficient coding. And this is an old thing that I've been dealing with, and very, very old because it's 2005. Yesterday I heard someone say 2015 was old. I don't remember who the speaker was, but okay, so this is ancient. So one is that temporal comodulation in the input signal from the exogenous world is an indication that you have a single object out there. But in, if you think in terms of efficient coding, even if you're in the context of predictive coding, then you would expect that this redundancy should be removed, otherwise it's not becoming efficient. So one of the studies we had done was capitalizing on this notion of temporal comodulation, again the same principle, but this time there is no easy labeling that you can get. So basically it's an audiovisual study. I'm just going to show you the stimuli, it's faster that way. So your goal here is to figure out what is the color of the random dot, which is the most coherent between the red and the green. So you will have two random dot kinematograms. One becomes more coherent, irrespective of the direction. Try to figure out which one it is. I can't see my mouse. Okay. Okay, it should be nearly an impossible task for you to do right now. It's extremely complicated, okay, so we agree on that. And you heard a little bit the sound, so there's no pop-out phenomenon. It's not useful for me to show that to you all the time because you won't have a pop-out effect. What's going on here is that we had three groups of participants, one which did this task only visually. Another group of participants heard these sounds that were exactly matched to the dynamics of the visual events. And another, a third group of participants who heard only white noise in the background, so totally uncorrelated and irrelevant noise. And the question was whether, against the attentional account, split attention between audition and vision, if you hear sound and you do a very complicated visual task, then you should be totally disrupted by the sound. But if the sound is beneficial for you to actually perform the task, then you would benefit from this sound. So that was the prediction here, and these were the psychophysics results, where we found that the audiovisual group actually improved. There's a clear threshold improvement as compared to the control or to the visual group. And what's very important here is that in the experimental design, which I forgot to say, in the brain data, what we looked at is the pre-training or pre-experimental setup, post-experimental setup, in which participants only saw visual event. So there's never any sound being presented. The only contrast we're going to do in the brain here is the history of a subject with respect to seeing or not this temporal comodulation being presented. So what we show here is that the response in HMT of the audiovisual group actually showed a change in the neurometric threshold, which we did not observe in the two other groups. I'm going very fast here. This is published work because I want to go to a specific point. And the interpretation we had done in the paper, along with a lot of different other markers that we saw in a spread out network, was made in the context of the reverse hierarchy that was proposed by Merav Haisar, with the idea that the implication of ventrolateral prefrontal cortex we saw in this study, suggesting that the stream of audition and vision converging there would actually benefit ultimately for you to do the task afterwards. And we have ongoing work, so this is totally unpublished because it's in progress work, and I'm putting this slide here because we heard a lot about beta prediction, showing that when we looked at functional connectivity and time frequency analysis, again in the absence of sound, because everything here is based on the history of the groups, we find that there is, after training, an increase of the gamma response in the occipital cortices, so as a function of the motion coherence that was presented, but there was a decrease actually of beta synchronization for the group that has learned most. And as you can see here, this means that you have a huge increase of functional connectivity, sorry, for the AV group. So I'm launching that out there as a top-down prediction, basically validated by beta, and the fact that you may actually be able to use temporal comodulation to establish some form of abstract representation that has nothing to do with speech in this case. Now, I'm going to move on to the notion of anatomical enslavement, and I guess that's a problem that I have when I read papers, so I'll share with you because I may be completely wrong about it. So by this I mean by structure function is if we think about a simple animal like the lamprey, and we think about the oscillators that generate that sort of movement, then we can have a very simple one-to-one mapping between the oscillator or the network that generates the oscillation and the actual movement of the animal. And this is what I would call the sort of structure function topology, I guess, conundrum. Now, when we read certain form of paper, so I selected one here because it was very clear in terms of the oscillatory response, the oscillations are being quantified in such a way that when we look at the phase response in the paper, there is a conclusion being made on the fact that the differences in the phase that we see between the two regions are basically telling us the latency between these two regions. And I guess my question here is, are we simply looking at the phase response as a simple conduction delay between two brain regions, or are we trying to say something more when we look at the phase of oscillatory response? So since the instigator we heard this morning of communication through coherence is in the room, I'll just ask myself whether this CTC also predicts basically that what we are recording is a simple conduction delay. And I guess not, at least from my reading, but I may be wrong, so I have extracted one sentence here, which makes me think that the asymmetrical input-output that we see in the different nodes may actually be what gives the function to the structure, so to speak. So the thinking here is that when we look at the phase response, we are not simply looking at a passive resonance, so to speak. So I'm going to illustrate this with a study on the temporal order. So if we think now about in terms of entrainment, the prediction of entrainment would be consistent, of course, with the CTC in the sense that you're going to have a resonant response with respect to the input that you give or the sensory input. So you entrain, so I've extracted this from the summary paper, review paper here, when we expect to have a, actually I didn't put it here, we expect to see an increase of the PLV and an increase of the power response at the frequency of the entrainment. But contrary to the notion that you may have endogenous control of the phase response or of the power response, the entrainment would predict that you would remain in phase with the sensory stimulation. So that phase should be stationary with respect to the input that you're giving in sensory domain. So for instance, to relate to some of our experiments, in these experiments, for instance, where we look at entrainment, there is a selective attention, but there is a switch from one stream of sensory stimuli to the other. So the stimuli are actually still responding the brain is still responding to the sensory inputs that are given to them, and the attentional is acting as a switch. But otherwise, the brain response is still steady with respect to the inputs. And I think in the literature, there's actually very little evidence for the endogenous control of this phase response. I'm citing two here, but there might be others that I've overlooked. I'm happy to hear about them. So I'm going to show you here data in which we show that the phase response can actually be controlled endogenously for the purpose of a time percept. So in this study, what we did is basically simplify the paradigm of seeing a badly dubbed movie in time when the sound and the visual events are desynchronized, except this time it was simply a beep and a flash, and they're desynchronized by roughly 200 milliseconds. There were different blocks in the experiment. What's interesting with this sort of paradigm is if you, you show a stream of audiovisual stimuli that are desynchronized by a certain amount of time, after a minute, you're going to reorder this event. You're going to change the simultaneity perception that you have of this event in time. So as a cartoon depiction, basically, if you adapt someone with these stimuli, although the veridical timing between audition and vision remains the same, your perception is as if the auditory and the visual events had come closer in time in terms of representation in your brain. So the working hypothesis here was that since we have an entrainment paradigm, either we're going to have a passive response, either the neural response is a passive entrainment or passive resonance to the inputs that is given to the system, or the phase response is going to have an active role in representing time or in time order, in which case, in this particular experiment, the prediction would be that you would have an advance of the auditory, or the representation of the auditory and in the visual, in the auditory cortex, and you would have a delayed representation of the visual event in the visual cortex to account for the perception, change perception in simultaneity. Again, I skipped through many different analyses that, again, Anne had done. The main point here was that we, when we looked at the phase differences at the beginning and at the end of the adaptation period, we found a correlation with the change in your perception of order, that in the perception of order that participant had. So the idea is that even though we're in a context of an entrainment paradigm, the phase differences are actually endogenously can be endogenously mastered, so to speak, and predict time order. Okay, how much time do I have? Because I'm a bad timekeeper, actually. 10? Oh, I'm very, 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 very late. Okay. Okay, I'm going to go straight to the speech then, if I have 10 minutes. Way too many stuff. Okay, so let's go to the speech. Okay, in this experiment, we, as many, were interested in the emerging computational principles that were proposed by Annelise and David, and we wanted to put to test the idea of sampling in the low frequency oscillations. So for this, we used bistable speech stimuli, which I can, in French, they are French, so let's see if it works on some of you.
Plan, 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 plan,
plan. So here you have a plan, you have the percept plan that changes, that is being repeated over time, and that goes from plan to lamp in French. So the idea was to have a stimulus that would not change, that would be steadily presented in the auditory domain, with the percept changing over time endogenously. There were four different kinds of stimuli that were tested. Some were monosyllabic and others were bisyllabic. That's what you have here represented. The speech waveforms. And in this particular task, we asked participants to actually maintain one of the stimulus in mind and neglect the other in different blocks. So what you have here is the performance of participants, and you can see that when we were asking them to, for instance, keep in mind the lamp percept, they were capable of doing it. When we asked them to perceive plan, they were also capable of doing it. So there was no, they were capable of doing the task, basically. The question we asked was whether, first with recording with MEG, whether there would be an inversion of the phase response in the low frequency, would we be looking at something akin to acoustic sampling and not really parsing? I have no time to go over this. So the naive sort of hypothesis, working hypothesis here, was that when participants would perceive plan versus when they would perceive lamp, given the same auditory stimulus, you're going to have a phase reversal of the brain response. Alternatively or complementary to this, you could actually have a coupling with the high frequency response, depending on the percepts that participants are using, with the idea that here we would have more something that we call linguistic parsing, which would be the discretization of inputs would differ depending on the percept that the participants would report having. So first, when we looked at all of the different conditions, there was no clear significant effect of in the phase response, so that's what you can see here. Of course, we're in the case here of a speech-evoked response, right? Because the signal is really entraining the brain response very strongly. And there was some slight differences in some of the conditions, but that was not a robust finding. And that was definitely not a phase reversal across percepts. When we looked at the bisyllabic words, non-words. We also looked at the 1.5 hertz response, which was clearly be seen in the signal. Similarly here, we did not find any phase differences for these stimuli. So neither the 3 Hz nor the 1.5 Hz were significant. Meaning that the first hypothesis, or the sort of naive hypothesis, was not realized in terms of changes in the phase response to the auditory stimuli. And partially this one was not valid either. In the more, to address the high frequency response, we actually proceeded with the speech-brain correlation. What I'm going to show you is the speech, is this representation here, which are basically the speech-brain correlation that are locked onto one plosive here. Each time locked for the plosive, irrespective of the percept that the participant is having. And we're going to look at the contrast between the two percepts. Okay, so the stimuli are the same and the percepts are the differential response. So here we see this for one individual. So the bottom line first is that when we looked at this sort of analysis in cross-average across all participants, we did not find significant results. So then we went back into each individual and looked at each individual whether to see what we could see in the brain response. What you see here is one participant. You are roughly around the gamma range here, low gamma, and you have here the modulation or the envelope of the gamma response as a function of a percept that was given by the participant. This is on average here, and you have each single trial. And what you can see for that participant is, for instance, that when he or she perceive plan, I'm not sure with the perspective I'm on the right, you would be at the trough, whereas on the lamp you would be at the peak. So in other words, the latency of the gamma response in this trial would differ. But when you look at which we also quantified here in terms of the phase, but this is to be read as a latency here in this case. When we look at a second participant at roughly around the same frequency, you had now a reversal. Even though you have a clear difference between the two percepts, you have also a clear difference in the latency response of the brain signal. So the point here is to say that in this particular case of volitional control on speech perception, when you have a speech stream where you have to maintain this representation in mind, then the high frequency is actually more telling than the low frequency or the sampling. That is, the idea is that we're not relying on an acoustic sampling, but we're actually relying on a representation that may be maintained in mind. As we saw that there were some possible phase effect in some of the conditions, one possibility, I think it was evoked this morning, would be that, in fact, the control of the phase shifts that we had observed could be driven by high-frequency responses. What we also saw was that when we looked at all of the frequency spectrum and sort of looked broadly across all participants at the power responses as a function of the percept, we also saw quite systematically some beta changes. You have each of the frequency that are being reported here. So that was an interesting point because it's predicted by some of the model for speech processing. So I think I will stop here. Maybe just one question, which is why it would be speech specific in terms of oscillation. So I just put that out there, which is, I guess everyone is familiar with the fact that the neural oscillations across across animal species are actually quite comparable. So it would be interesting to perhaps think about why for humans it would be dedicated to speech. And okay, so thank you.
The last experiment, maybe I misunderstood it, but you had a shift in the illusion. You went from plum-lump into lump-plump at some point. There was a switch.
Naturally, if you don't give any instruction, participants have a bistable type of percept. So they will spontaneously switch from plum to lump. But in this particular experiment, we asked them to maintain one over the other. So sometimes they spontaneously switched and could not maintain. Yeah.
So if they switch, how your explanation, what is your explanation in terms of the gamma, theta, you know, change in phase?
What would be the, we haven't looked at it empirically. Yeah, that's a good question. The Anne actually looked also at the spontaneous data. So we replicated these results with the spontaneous data. That is the blocks in which we did not ask them to maintain the speech in mind. But it's much more complicated because of the variance in terms of the, so to control for, to balance out all the trials and so on. The main effects are still there. But I think it would require another experiment to actually address specifically that point, yeah.
Can I say something about the, I guess also about the end? I mean, you said somewhat boldly that the parsing, that the lower frequency acoustic parsing doesn't matter, but then...
Did I say that? No.
Well, you said something like that. If you go a slide back or two, that it's the... Somewhere there, I don't remember where it was.
Maybe in the phase or something.
Well, here, well, the point where you make, I mean, you make the point that it's the it's the gamma activity with respect to the phase of the theta activity that matters, right? In the decoding of getting the right answer, but the theta activity is, of course, closely coupled to the acoustics. I'm a little confused about your interpretation there. They're not uncoupled.
Yeah, we are confused also, so that's fine. I mean, we don't have... because the point was that effectively what we were expecting is to see a clear coupling, in which case we would also be able, through the way we proceeded with the phase analysis, to normalize across participants and see a clear average response for everyone, because you have to normalize somehow when you're going to look at the phase response. Which we did not see. So already that's a cue that even if the phase mattered, then it mattered on a not with respect fully to the stimulus, because it would be entrained directly from the stimulus, but actually from each brain. And then the second point was the phase, the low frequency oscillation was the main parser, then you would expect an entire shift. So the idea is that you may have actually a control of the phase. The small shift in the phase that you have may, in fact, be controlled by the major latency shift we see in gamma, for instance. But it's very limiting here because we only have these effects at the individual level. So it would have to be done through very specific analysis.
Yes, Nina.
I was just curious, was your presentation of the of those words, was it totally, like, what was the SOA? Was it absolutely consonant?
I forgot. And what was the... So it was constant, yeah.
Yeah, because I don't know whether you can elicit the same, like, I think by stable illusion, like, I mean, this would be still available if you jittered it slightly, and maybe in that jittered condition, you allow theta, I mean, you release the theta a bit, and then it can, you know, actually, like, so do what... You know,
so
your story
put more
sound... So do, right, which is lock... You know, at the change of perception interval, then it kind of resets.
I think if you do this, you start having a confound, bottom-up confound with the acoustic signal, though. I mean, first you would disrupt the bistability, the perceptual bistability, because you don't have anymore the same stream that goes on. And second, you would have a possible confounding effect of the bottom-up resetting, which we wanted to avoid.
Okay.
Yes, but then.
You know, when you showed the CLAM lamp stimulus, you know, what I was immediately thinking about, and again, this is the first time I saw it, and I'm just saying something, you know, that I didn't double check as a possibility. It goes back to what Peter talked about in his talk last, which was that, you know, the upper half of the envelope, of the cochlear envelopes, and the lower half are in, you know, misphase because of the fact that you have fricatives there and, you know, vowels there. And with the lamp PLAM, you know, you have those plosives and energies. So maybe there is the mechanism that is suggested in terms of, you know, pulling up a theta because of the change of those, of the relationship of consonant vowels, you know, that may be the reason for the change be, the phase change, the phase difference. So it's not the gamma that is changing, but maybe the theta that is changing because of that.
Okay, I would have to think about this. I mean, I think in this paradigm, we basically put all the emphasis on the fact that you don't have to really sample the stream, right? The stream is being so predictable. At some point, it's questionable whether you actually still actively sample or parse that, that acoustic stream. So that's why I'm hesitant to say.
Any more questions, folks? Then thank you, Virginie. Thank you very much.